watching these two teams come out. The first two teams didn't even look around during warm-ups.
As we're getting the 15-10 Mark Tudor Panthers against the 26-1 Bearcats of Wheeler High School. Here's the starting lineup for the home team on the score.
Head coach of the Wheeler Bearcats is Mike Jones. He is his sixth season at Wheeler. Part of an athletic renaissance, this 2A school in Northwest Indiana. 115-28 is his career record at Wheeler.
Mike Jones,
their big body at 6'7", and Rudakas, their key player. But Todorovic, Ketchum, and Bailey all play big roles for this Wheeler Bearcats squad. Yogi Farrell makes it 5-1.
Kids, this is a group of kids from Wheeler that have been together for a long time, playing together not only in grade school, high school, but also in AAU basketball.
No one is more superstitious than athletes, coaches, or fans. Farrell to the team. Bearcats on a 4-0 run. Three. Rudakas. Second May three for Wheeler. Three assists a game. Farrell up and over. Boy, Sinovic. Farrell's got 10 of the Mark Tudor 15.
Again, you can't keep Yogi Farrell in front of you. It's just hard. Bailey tried. He couldn't do it. Eddie Schilling isolated him left side. Kucinovic has to be there at his side.
19, Mark Tudor 15. Halftime show comes your way next on the Indiana Cable Network.
Seven is as deep as Mark Tudor will go. Catch and shoot Todorovic for three, and that is good.
That shot, you have to play this game faster if you're Mark Tudor.
Boy, Sinovic, that's where Wheeler's got to go every trip down.
Really nice set play by Coach Joe.
Dan, we mentioned this earlier that there are a lot of coaches in the building. The majority of them looking at Yogi Farrell in this game. Are they liking what they're seeing so far?
Yeah, I think so. He hasn't had his best basketball.
Take a look at it here. The officials are discussing it right now. Boy, Sinovic just calls Farrell. He'll catch uncontested in the backcourt. Block in the lower right-hand corner to screen. The second screen forces the issue. No. Rebound tipped. Tiger on the dribble. Farrell has to get it out. On the bounce and time.
State your name. Who are you?
Mike Jones.
When you were younger, what brought you to the game of basketball?
Well, when I was younger, I really didn't have, which was kind of weird, I thought. I didn't have a real parent influence. You know, my dad grew up in Arkansas. My mom came over from Germany when she was like 6 years old. So my parents weren't really athletes, so to speak. But I hung around a lot of kids that played sports when I was growing up, and I kind of played everything when I was younger. So I enjoyed baseball probably the most, which was kind of surprising at the time because I ended up never playing once I got through middle school. But I played all the sports when I was growing up just because of the people I hung around with and the people that, you know, my biggest influence from basketball was probably my teacher in sixth grade, Gary Webster, was his name at Hazel Leonard Elementary. And he'd always open up the gym every morning before school, and we'd always go there and play. And that's probably what got me really involved early, wanting to play basketball.
What do you think separated you from the other players on the team?
I'd say my ability to shoot. I was never going to be a guy who was going to jump the highest or run the fastest, so I was going to have to be good at something to kind of separate myself from everybody else. And I think growing up, I kind of knew that, so I spent a lot of time shooting the ball. And, you know, once I got into the middle school level and the high school level, I think that kind of stood out compared to other players. And, you know, I think that was the biggest key for me as far as being able to shoot the ball so well going up against older kids.
What motivated you as a player?
I think the ability to, with like I said, my lack of, I was getting guarded a lot in high school by kids that were maybe 3-4 inches taller than me, more athletic. So I had to outthink them. I had to find out ways to defeat them other than just by, you know, athleticism. So I think that motivated me more than anything. I had to try to beat the opponent more mentally than anything else. Otherwise, I was going to struggle to get shots. So I think that was the biggest thing that motivated me, was trying to beat opponents by outthinking them instead of necessarily being more athletic.
Do you describe yourself the same way now?
Things have kind of, I think from a coaching standpoint, I think I do. I think because when I got into coaching, you know, being able to have to outthink my opponent and everything made me think things through from a coaching standpoint, you know, game planning, preparation. So I felt like from that standpoint, yeah, I had a lot from my way I played kind of transferred over to how I coached from a standpoint of having to outthink the opponent standpoint, yeah.
Do you have any core memories from high school basketball?
Yeah, I had some individual matchups against players that, you know, I'd see in the summer and stuff. But the biggest one was probably Kirk Manns, who played at North Judson High School at the time. We played each other at North Judson in high school our junior year, and he ended up scoring 52 points against us, and I ended up scoring 41, and we ended up beating him by 10. And that was really big with one player scoring that many and you know, myself scoring in the 40s. That was a huge game.
What did you want to do after high school?
After high school? Well, I wanted to go play in college. So I had offers. I had multiple college offers to play Division I, and that was a goal of mine. Obviously playing in high school. So my biggest thing there was to try to get a full ride school-wise and play in college.
What offers did you get?
I had Valparaiso University, obviously was one. I had University of Mississippi. That's where I ended up going to originally. Western Michigan recruited me heavily. USC out in California was one. That one came about because the coach at the time ended up just getting the job. George Raveling was his name. He used to be the head coach at Iowa. He had just got the USC job. And a big thing for me, which helped in recruiting for me, was the transition. There was no three-point line my senior year in high school, but that changed my freshman year in college. That's when it came in. So everybody was looking for shooters because they didn't know how the three-point line was going to change the game, which you guys obviously know now has changed it immensely. And at that time, that made me a hot commodity as far as finding a shooter that could, you know, for college, because nobody knew what that was going to do.
So why Valpo?
Well, crazy thing there was I originally went to the University of Mississippi. I was 18 years old. I was, you know, I want to play at the biggest school possible, you know, and that was in the SEC, you know, we were going to play Kentucky and all those teams. So the ironic story behind that one is I went to high school with a girl that their family knew the assistant coach at Mississippi. Well, they told him to come up. We had a shooter at Valpo to come up, and we were playing Michigan City actually that night. So he came up for a weekend, and he went to go watch us play at Michigan City. Well, I had a really good game, had like 30 points. He calls me that night when I got home, and then offered me a full ride.
When did you realize you could play at a high level?
I ended up because the coaches in the summer at the University of Mississippi were fired. So they came up with new coaches. So I went down to Mississippi for a week. I didn't know the coaches. Got homesick, came back right away. So I go to VU. I get released to play as a freshman. So I go through workouts. First game of our season, we're playing Western Michigan, who had recruited me. So we're playing them at VU. I don't start the game, I come off the bench. Okay, there's foul trouble. I come off the bench in the second half. I end up scoring 20 points in the second half, my first game I've ever played as a freshman in college. And that pretty much gave me a good idea that I could play at that level when I had that game.
What was the transition like from going to a bench player to a starter?
That was a big difference. I mean, again, that was the same time we had a change in coaching too. So a lot more freedom. I went from I went from averaging about, you know, 8-9 points a game as a sophomore to 17-18 as a junior. And my junior year was probably overall my best year. I ended up like being one of the leading three-point shooters in the country, shot like almost 50% from the field, averaged 18. Our team was one of the best three-point shooters in the country. And there's a big difference. I mean, from it was like night and day from my sophomore year to my junior year as far, and again, that was a lot to do with the coaching change. But yeah, I went from averaging like 8-9 points to 17-18 from my sophomore to my junior year.
And with those two missed fouls, that could do it.
They've got to get it up, Tom, because they need two scores now. They need two scores. They just have to shoot the ball.
Going into the Notre Dame game, not having the best record, how confident were you guys?
Well, not really. Not very confident. They were undefeated. They had LaFonso Ellis at the time, who was a freshman. And the funny thing about that is we had final exams that week, and we actually had a final that morning on a Saturday. So guys were kind of locked in on obviously getting through finals before we could get focused on the game. And obviously with them being undefeated and ranked 19th in the country, you know, we weren't, you know, expected to do well. And obviously it was going to be a big crowd, but a lot of that had to do with Notre Dame coming in there. Notre Dame would not very often would come to VU to play. So, you know, we weren't real, you know, confident coming in that we were going to be able to beat them, but maybe that was less pressure on us coming into the game.
Who are you?
I'm Mike Rosta, counselor at Wheeler High School.
How do you know Mike Jones?
I've known Mike for years. We kind of both grew up in Valpo, so he was, I think, just a year older than I was when we went through high school, and I just knew the name Mike Jones because of him playing basketball.
You've mentioned to me before that you were at the Notre Dame-Valpo game. Do you have any specific memories from that game?
My brother went to Notre Dame, and he was actually there at Notre Dame that year, and he brought a bunch of friends home, and we bought, I want to say there were 8 or 10 tickets, and we all went to the game, and they were razzing us that they were going to kill us the whole time, and so we were sitting up quite high, and, you know, having a couple Valpo guys, and I was at VU at the time, and I knew a couple of the players on the team, so it was kind of fun for me to see guys I knew playing in such a big game. I knew it was on TV too, so it was an unbelievable atmosphere watching the game. I mean, it was exciting that we were close the whole time. Somewhere I wish I still had my T-shirt that we had from the ball game, but it was unbelievable. And knowing Mike and knowing, you know, Scott Anselm and some of the other guys on the team really kind of even made it more enjoyable to watch.
What was the Notre Dame game like?
Well, I mean, there was a lot of times during the game, you know, going into halftime, it was a close game, and then starting the second half, I remember them getting a little bit ahead of us, like by 7 or 8, and we had to call an early timeout and start the second half, and then everybody kind of sensed that, okay, they're going to kind of pull away. And then shortly but surely, we ended up, you know, hanging around. You know, and that's all we were trying to do, considering who we're playing against. They had us outmanned size-wise at pretty much every position. So we were trying to just hang around in the second half, and then it got to the point under 10 minutes to where we're right there, and now all of a sudden they start to feel pressure. And, you know, now the game starts to get a little bit more intense because now the game's getting close, and now we're down to 5-6 minutes to go, and now anything can happen. And that's kind of where we were trying to do in the second half, just kind of hang in there to give ourselves a chance at the end.
What type of player was Jones in college?
Well, you wouldn't know it today because I don't think since that ball game I've seen him shoot the ball. Even in the summers, I'd see him working with his boys and he'd never shoot the ball. But he was a shooter. He was the guard that would distribute, and he was the one who would set things up, and when he needed to be, he could be a scorer.
When did you realize you could win?
I think the biggest point was probably at the end of regulation. They went to the foul line to kind of win the game. They were up 2 and they had a 1-1. Well, they missed the 1-1. The ball gets deflected out and it got tipped to me out on the wing. I looked up
passed it up because I saw a teammate. Actually, it was Scott Anselm was the teammate. I passed it up to him in a kind of a break because we're trying to get it off before the buzzer went off. And he passed it back to me, and I ended up lighting it up right at the buzzer to force overtime. And I think then, you know, with the emotion and the crowd, and I think then everything, when we went to the huddle then, before the overtime, everybody knew, like, okay, we could actually do this.
What was your initial reaction when Jones hit that game-time layup to send Velpo to overtime?
There have really only been a few times in my life where I've been at a sporting event where the place just went absolutely nuts. I mean, I felt that at Notre Dame football games. I felt that at Cup playoff games. And it was the same type of atmosphere. I mean, my goodness, when you're a small school like VU and you're battling Notre Dame and Digger Phelps was there and all these big names of players you've heard, it was probably one of the most exciting sporting events I've ever been at.
Over time, we kind of got out into an early start on them and got the lead. And what it came down to then, they needed a three. We were up three, and they needed a three to tie. And it was kind of, they missed. They kind of got a rebound, shot it up again. The balls got loose, and the ball was kind of loose in a scramble mode. And then the clock, you know, just ends up running out with them not being able to score. And then everybody just rushes the floor, and everybody goes crazy, so.
Three-pointer. Singleton, no. Rebound, Jackson. 2 seconds. 1 second. It's over. It's over. Valparaiso upsets Notre Dame. 71-68 in overtime.
Did you have any NBA scouts looking at you?
No, I wasn't, like I said, I wasn't athletic enough, tall enough. I had some opportunities to go play overseas, but that wasn't really me to go out of the country to try to play. So I ended up not wanting to pursue that just because I wasn't a guy that wanted to travel. I was more of a homebody and enjoyed being around here, so I didn't pursue anything overseas.
What was the process like becoming the head coach at Wheeler?
Well, at the time, I spent a few years I'd spent a few years under when Randy Stelter was the coach. I was a few years as his assistant coach, so I worked under Randy, who was really good for me. He gave me an opportunity to run the offense. I called a lot of the stuff on the offense, and he gave me that freedom. So he had a lot of trust in me to do that. And I think that helped me a lot because when we got into games, I was able to call. We were really good back then, you know, 20-win teams. I was able to call big games offensively as an assistant, which, you know, I might not have had, you know, that experience if you know, Randy Stelter wouldn't have gave me that opportunity. So I was really grateful for him to give me that opportunity because it really helped me then when I transitioned in to be a head coach. I already had some of that experience working with him for 2 or 3 years doing that.
Introduce yourself and how you are related to Jones.
My name is Andrew Rudakas. He was my coach all through high school. Graduated 2010, so that was the year we won state. And that was my... basketball coach. Just that's how I know him the best. And yeah.
What was your first impression of Coach Jones?
Serious. He's a very serious guy at first until you get to know him. Which was intimidating because until you get to know him and you learn his very dry sense of humor. I don't know if that's changed over the years, but when he was our coach, it was once you got to know that, it was the funniest thing. But until then, very intimidating, serious guy, but I think that's kind of what a coach should be.
My name is Aleksa Kojcinovic. I'm 30 years old now, and I'm currently living in Ljubljana in Slovenia in Europe.
How do you know Coach Jones?
When I came to the States, I came to Wheeler High School as an exchange student. He was the head coach of the basketball team, and also he was a teacher in my gym class. So my first introduction to Coach Jones was actually in the gym class, and I remember that day quite well. It was I didn't know that he was the coach at the time, but I don't know, maybe it was the first or second day I came to the school, and actually at the gym class. He knew that I was playing basketball and that I will try to get on the team. So in the first gym class, he right away, I forgot who, maybe it was Eric Wise. I think it was Eric Wise who was who also came to that gym class, and coach just gave us the ball. And I mean, I didn't have my gym shoes or anything. I was just, you know, ready for a gym class, not a basketball practice. And in those like 40 minutes and half an hour, like he was, he gave us a bunch of drills to do just to check what I can do, what I know. And right away it was, I think it was clear for to both of us, who to also to Eric, that we will, that it will be a good team that year.
When you first started coaching, did you see any potential in the state team?
When I first took over the head coaching job at Wheeler, we had never won a sectional before in the history of the school. So my main focus was, what can we do? We were really close a number of years. So my main focus was, what can we do to get over that hump and win a sectional? So, and I always like to look at things in three-year periods. When I took over the job, I said, okay, where are we at? We first lost, we had lost our starting five when I took the job. So we were kind of starting from, we had a really good JV team. They'd won 18, 20 games. So we had good kids coming up, but they were inexperienced. So I was thinking, you know, in this three-year period with development, where can we get to, you know, to try to get to the point where we can win a sectional? The thought of a state championship was not in my mind when I took over the job. It was, what do we need to do to get better, to get over the hump of winning a sectional? Because we'd never won one before. That was my first priority.
How do you get better at coaching?
You gotta build relationships with players. You gotta get to know personalities of players. You gotta know that I can yell at this guy and he'll go through a wall for you. I can yell at that guy and he'll not respond. You know, you gotta know that. The only way you know that is by building relationships. There's tons of, every game I coached, I made mistakes. And the biggest thing I think I learned from those things is you gotta be willing to look in the mirror and take responsibility for what you do well and what you don't do well. I think that's what I tried to preach to the kids, is that, you know, they need, I wanted them to be able to look in the mirror and say, and take responsibility for what they need to do to be better, not blame the, you know, blame is the easiest thing you can do. Everybody's got an excuse. I was trying to get them to understand, you know, take responsibility for what you need to do to get better. And that's what I was trying to do with a coach. You know, if I made a mistake, I try to stand up in front of the team and tell them I did a poor job at this or this, and this is what I need to do better. And that's kind of how I coached. I was willing to look in the mirror and say, you know, what do I need to do to get better? And that's what I try to do every time I coached. It didn't matter that I played at a high level in high school and that I played Division I basketball. You still have to learn how to coach. Now, that stuff helped me when I learned how to coach. But, you know, just because you came in there as a good player or a Division I player does not mean that you're going to be a good coach. You got to learn how to do that, just like you had to learn how to play when you're, you know, coming out of school.
Did you like his coaching style? And if so, what did you like about it?
Oh yeah, definitely. If there was a player that was playing good, he kept that, he let the ball keep going to that player. If Pitar was shooting threes and he was hitting them, keep passing it to Pitar. If I was hitting it, keep going inside to me or whatever. And we've all said it, and I think we all still agree he's the best coach we've ever had.
This is my example of looking in the mirror. For me, winning 21 games, winning the sectional, no one's really gonna question me as far as, you know, coach, you need to do a better job at this or that. So I had to be willing to look in the mirror and say, okay, what do we need to do to get to the next level and get past sectionals and win a regional? I felt like that season, we needed to make it more about the team, more about three or four guys in double figures instead of one or two. That was gonna make us hard to guard. So that's what we went after to do the year after that season, because we had our top three scorers coming back. We knew we were going to be good, but it was just a matter of making it more about the team, where we could have three, four guys in double figures instead of maybe just one or two.
What were your thoughts on your key players like Ketchum, Todorovic, Rudakas, and Bailey?
Yeah, those guys are the, you know, as far as building the program and taking it to another level, those guys are the main guys who were able to do that. Now, I thought the biggest, you know, those guys were freshmen. Najee was actually in eighth grade. He was a year younger than them. But Andrew Rudakas and Pitar Todorovic, Donnie Ketchum, those guys were freshmen when Nate Casper was a senior, Derek Hyland was a senior, and Devin Schleter was a senior. Those guys helped us win the first sectional in the history of the school in 2007. And Andrew and all those guys were freshmen, and they watched what happened. I mean, they were brought along. Andrew ended up starting for us as the year went on as a freshman, so he got to see it firsthand. But Those guys kind of saw what Casper and Hyland and those guys did as seniors to win the first sectional ever, and then they kind of built it from there the next three or four years.
What were your first impressions of Coach Jones?
Oh, that's an interesting one. Yeah, Coach Jones is, how to say, he's quite reserved and quiet guy. So I would say that he, at first, he has some shield that I would say he would put on and kind of doesn't let you get close very easily. But once you do establish some close connection, then he's very kind, very open. How to say, I enjoyed his jokes. He had a really specific sense of humor, and that was really interesting.
What are your thoughts on Aleksa Kojcinovic?
Well, he was huge for us. I mean, a lot of people would say that, he only averaged 8 points a game coming in, which is true, and he was our fourth, fifth option. But, having a guy of that size come in and help a team that's already won 21 games was a huge advantage for us. And he did a lot of things that, didn't get seen in the, stats necessarily, with his size, his ability to pass, his ability to do a lot of things for us that made it hard for us to guard. He was able to do for us. And he was a big part of what caused us to be able to take the next step, no question about it.
As we know Jones, he's a calm and collective guy. Would you say that he's always been like that?
Yes. He's very reserved and keeps to himself, between, his son and my son playing baseball against each other or watching him at basketball games. He's the guy who likes to be off by himself, just kind of taking in the sporting event. He doesn't want to be there talking to people. I think it's one of those where if he was among the people wouldn't leave him alone. They'd want to talk to him and ask him questions. And he's always kind of been the reserve guy who kind of stands off by himself. And I think some people take that as kind of an attitude or an elitist personality, but that's not Mike. I mean, Mike is... He wants to take in the game. He wants to watch his kids play. He wants to see how things are. Because once you get him talking, he doesn't stop talking. But he has to feel comfortable with you, and he has to be used to you. And then he talks a lot.
Tell us who you are.
Nick Smith.
How did you become the assistant coach?
Well, I actually was coaching in the middle school here when I first got hired in, and so I wanted to move up into the high school and coach there. And so when the C-team opened, I just applied for it and just sat down and had a conversation about what my aspirations were at that time and what he was looking for in a C-team coach.
What were your first impressions of Jones?
First impression is that he is a very detailed, oriented person. Everything that we talked about from the very beginning when I started coaching there was how are you going to run practices? What's your practice plan? What are you thinking? Like, here's what I want done, but how are you going to do things in that structure? So very detail oriented.
What's one thing you learned from Coach Jones that you still do today?
I just think the level of competitiveness that he expected from us, I think he knew the type of team we had and the type of players we had, and we all wanted one goal. At the start of every year, we would get our binder, and I still have all of them, and he would list out our goals, and we all agreed on it. We never were like, oh, I don't know if we're gonna win regionals, I don't know if we can get to semi-state. Like, the goal was always the same thing every year.
Everyone already knew what the goal was. I mean, that was something that he had set up in advance. It was very on purpose, the schedule that they played. It was very on purpose, the way practices ran and how summers went and the schedule and tournaments. And so if you saw him in a situation where it was coaching, he was focused on coaching. So there was nothing else to go on or to talk about. It was that moment and what we're doing. And if it was getting ready for a game, it was film. I mean, Peyton Manning's nickname is the caveman from college because of all the film he watched. You could say the same thing about Coach Jones. And so if he was quiet, it's because he was focused. And if he had the ability to joke and talk, but he was a very focused and determined individual.
What is one thing that you learned from Coach Jones?
Well, this, like I mentioned now, definitely this balance between joyful time and business time, but Also, I think he was a great mentor and how to say, he, now when I'm older and when I was able to retrospectively look back at the team and all the qualities that we had, I think he managed very well to utilize the best of all of us, of everything that each one of us players could contribute to the team. And that goes from every single player on the team, the starting five and the guys on the bench, on the people that were around the team. And I think this was, I really appreciate this and respect this knowledge and how to say, the skill to motivate people to give their best at each time and to be able to recognize how each person can contribute and also to show each person on the team that they're valued in different way, that we, not all of us can do all the things, and but it's important that you do your role the best you can, and he was able to do this very well.
What were your specific thoughts on the players that year?
As far as the team goes and the starting lineup specifically, everybody knew their role. Everybody had a position to play and a part that they had to fill. And that was something that coach had laid out for them. It wasn't just that, you're a scorer and here's what you can do on the floor. It was very specific. And so they had to meet those expectations. That's because it was designed to work around them. It wasn't something that they were just plugged into. So, you know, Donnie Ketchum was the point guard, and he had a 6'1", 6'2" body, and he was bigger, and so he was able to do different things on the floor. I mean, you've got Aleksa down low, who also could move outside and shoot. You had the same thing with Rudakas. He could play down low. He could also be outside. He had a great shooter who developed into a driver and a passer with Qatar. And it was an interesting group to watch them play because they learned a lot about each other, and it was neat to see Aleksa fit into that being new. But again, it was something that wasn't like, hey, go on the floor, here's our structure, do your thing. It was, no, this is what we're trying to do, and here's how you fit into this, and we're going to play to your strengths. And so I think they all knew that and understood that and were willing to accept it because they knew what the goal was, where they were trying to get, and it was something that was reinforced on a regular basis.
What's one experience with Coach Jones that you'll never forget?
I mean, we had some really good teams, but I would say on a more personal level, there was an incident my senior year. We were on a hot streak at the start of the season, and we played Andrean, and that was our only loss that year.
Describe your only loss the state season versus Andrean.
Yeah, I think, you know, nobody wants to lose. But I think from a coaching standpoint, because we knew we were going to be good, I think I was able to use that loss against them whenever we got a little bit full of ourselves and thought we were maybe better than we should be and maybe we didn't practice the way we needed to practice. I could always use that Andrean loss because technically the timing of that Andrean loss that week, we had played a really good Griffith team 2 days before that and put a lot of our emphasis on that game. And I felt like we came out and we still had a chance to win the Andrean game, but I don't feel like we played our best. I thought if we'd have played them again, we'd have beat them.
I was hot after that game, not happy. And I came into the locker room and I hit the wall of the locker room. And on that wall, there was a big state championship football picture for Andrean. And I remember it falling down and it broke. And we all sat down and he came in last. He asked who did it, and I raised my hand, and I didn't say anything. And I, to some degree, he didn't say much either, but to some degree, he said something like, you know, those guys won a state championship, and, you know, don't disrespect that. And I remember from that moment on, like, I was embarrassed, but he wasn't mad. But the next day, he called me into his office, and I was thinking to myself, damn, I'm gonna start running some lines today. Like I'm gonna get it. And we wrote like an apology letter to them and got it over there. And he just told me, you know, just sat me down a little bit and just less of a coach, more like a father conversation at that point was just like, don't, you can't do that type of stuff. And I was just like, I know. And I explained to him frustrations, and he understood competitiveness and like the frustrations that came from that. And he didn't punish you because you were frustrated for that. And that was really cool.
Because we lost, I could always kind of use that game against them all year. You know, whenever we thought we were better than maybe we should be, you know, we are. I could use that Andrain loss to help us moving forward.
The only misstep they had that year was Andrain. And you can say it was a misstep because we lost, but really I think it was a catalyst that propelled them through the rest of the season, because it refocused them on, if we don't do things and if we forget where we're supposed to be at, or if we don't work as a team, unfortunately, this is the result. This is what can happen. And so I think it was a wake-up call.
In the beginning of the season, did you think State was in the picture?
It was at that Andrain game. So we, as I mentioned, we were on a little bit of a streak. We were all feeling good. And not too long ago, I talked with Donnie and Pitar, and we both kind of agreed it was at that point where losing that game sucked, but it was also losing that game that kind of grounded us again, because we were, you know, you're 17, 18 years, you're cocky, you're winning games, you're feeling good. It brought us back down and got us zoned in and focused. And I think it was at that game, at that same incident where I hit the one photo off the wall, where I found a new respect for what that meant if you win State, and really zoning in and wanting to win.
What were practices like? Like I mentioned before, like, Coach Jones was very cool guy to be around socially, and funny guy making jokes and all that. But once the practice starts, then it's serious time. Then everybody knows their roles, everybody knows what's expected to do.
There was no messing around. I mean, you knew you could maybe mess around if he was joking around at something, which did happen, but it was more so practice like you played, go hard. We ran drills that were very hard and physical drills that, you know, you're getting beat up.
His practice plans were very meticulous. I mean, down to the minute, everything had its place, everything had a purpose. And every game situation that you could think of was practice. There was nothing left to chance. It wasn't, hey, if we're down by four, they knew what to do. They had practiced that. They were set up with a little bit of time left on the clock, and how do we manage this? Here's what we're gonna run on the sideline, if it's man or if it's zone or whoever we're facing.
Kind of that balance between having fun and getting job done. And that was very clear with him. There were a lot of times where, you know, we were all kids. I mean, at this time, it's tough to switch from this, you know, playing around to being serious time. And a lot of times we as kids would take this joking a bit further, and then there were repercussions for this, and lots of running suicides. So there were puking in practices also involved. It was tough. It was not easy for sure.
How tough was the Southwood game?
Yeah, that game was pretty intense from the standpoint of, they kind of pressed us the whole game and forced us to play fast. And what I liked about our team at that point is we could play fast or we could play slow. We could play any way you wanted to play, and that's what I liked. And that's what any coach would love to be able to do. It's just you very rarely have a team that could do that. So we had a team in that case that we were going to have to play fast because they pressed. And the biggest thing that stuck out to me in that game was we had a lead of like 10 points late in the third quarter, and they made a run. They ended up tying the game with about 4 minutes to go. We turned the ball over, and I called timeout. So I bring our guys over, and I tell them, I said, look, they're not going to give us the game. We have to go out and win the game. And what I thought was really good about that is then we come out of the timeout, we get a turnover, and then Donnie Ketchum comes down right away and goes off the glass and scores. And right from that point on, you know, I kind of had that feeling that we were going to win. But that was pretty much the moment where when we turned the ball over and it was tied, and they made a run and came back and tied it, and we were 10 up, I called timeout with like 3-4 minutes to go, and we talked about, we have to take this if we want to go to the state championship, because they're not going to give it to us. And our guys stepped up.
What was it like to be able to make it to the state game?
Well, that was pretty special. If you think about that season and everything leading up to it, it wasn't just that season that got them there. It really started when he took over. So being at that state game was a really cool culmination of everything that he had done from the beginning, creating a culture of winning basketball at Wheeler, from how you dress on game days and how you dress on the bus, and how you act when you show up into the gym, how you prepare mentally for practice and the games. And then to see all of that pay off when they get there, to watch the team's faces when they go into the stadium and just see how big it is coming in from the floor rather than being a spectator at a game, which they had done before, was pretty cool. But then to see how that all played out, that for those few days that we were down there, it's just kind of a different experience that is difficult to put into words because each person has their own special moment. For me, it was seeing everyone walk onto that floor for the first time when they got to practice, and there's the enormity of the stadium. And then to see this the crowd that showed up for an Indiana high school basketball game is pretty special.
Did you think that that team was going to win state in the beginning of the year?
We went to quite a few of the games, and we knew we were good. I don't know if we thought we were that good, at least as a school person. You know, you always think your school's good, but you never know how good. And then when we started to win a lot of games and how easily we were winning them, I mean, there were some nip and tuck, sectional, regional, semi-state, but I think once we won regionals and semi-state, we thought we had a really good chance. You know, you always worried because you heard the name Yogi, and you weren't sure what he was capable of doing. But Mike knew what he was doing.
I was shocked about the newspaper, because back home, this like newspaper don't write about kids, don't write about the youth teams and so forth. So yeah, I was aware of the things that were being written in the newspaper, and that Wheeler had really good team the year before, and then now they were also talking how when I came, I brought the missing link to the team, and then we have high chances to go far into the championship.
The possibility was always there, but it's not something that we hung on the wall and was like, hey, this is what we're doing, this is what we're doing. Everybody knew it. Everybody knew the goal was to get there, but you can't get there unless you do step one. And then once you do step one, you've got to get to step two. So it wasn't like, hey, we've got this team on the schedule, but really we're looking to state. No, we've got this team on the schedule, and all your efforts are going to be put into this team.
Prior to the whole playoffs, what was the atmosphere like around Wheeler home games?
It was different. I think it's normal like that for any sport. I think you can even look at pro sports. When teams are winning, the stands are packed. When they're not winning, they're not.
There was a lot of anticipation because the previous year they had made it to regionals finals and they lost. And so it was a team that had a lot of expectations, especially with a transfer student coming in, a foreign exchange student who could play ball. He was big, he could pass, he could shoot. And so it was this idea of, okay, we did this last year, and the plan was to get to state last year. The plan hasn't changed. We have all these things in place. So I think there was a lot of expectation, but I think it was also measured, because the one thing that Coach was really good about is not letting players get too far ahead of where they were at.
And when you've got a team that's winning all the time and they were exciting and they were big personalities, the stands were packed. I mean, you had to get to the ball game or you weren't going to have a seat. And the stands were full and the atmosphere was unbelievable. You know, you had little kids there wanting to get autographs from the high school players. And, you know, it was a totally different atmosphere. But like I said, it's different when you're winning.
It was once we won regionals where I felt like, I think the school and the students and other people in the community, parents and stuff, they really started to get really excited for it.
What improvements did you need to make after the Southwood game?
Well, the state game, you're going against, Yogi Ferro, who's going to be a former, go to IU and be a former, an NBA player. So from that standpoint, you're going against a guy where, the level's going to be different. You know, he's going to be the best player on the floor, and you got to come up with a strategy to where you're trying to get the ball out of his hands and kind of make some other guys have to beat you because he's so good. If you let him get going, you know, he can single-handedly win the state championship for him because of how good he is.
Did you adjust the game plan at all at halftime?
The Park Tudor game, we really didn't adjust it. We didn't double Yogi in the first half because he wasn't super aggressive. We already had the game plan in during the week that if he got aggressive, we were going to trap him when he came over half court, who we were going to trap off of, and then who we were going to allow shoot.
Yogi was super fast at that age still. So he was really quick. He was a good shooter, a fast, high release, you know, jumps high on his jump shot. I remember that. And so playing against someone who obviously was an elite player was a lot of fun.
He came in and he was ready to play. I mean, he scored the majority of Park Tudor's points. He handled the ball. He really controlled the flow. So the thing that we had to do was slow it down.
But we didn't use that game plan in the first half. The second half in the third quarter, he got super aggressive. And that's when we said we're going to go to that strategy, basically into the third quarter, into the start of the fourth quarter, and we started doubling him.
And so the decision was made. I remember this, you know, Coach Jones on the bench was to, as soon as he got the ball and crossed half court later in the game, is to run somebody at him, force him out of his comfort zone, make him give the ball to someone else, and see if anyone else is willing to step up. And that really paid off. It disrupted their flow, getting the ball out of his hand. And then if he's running around, getting off the screens, trying to get it back, and we've got someone chasing, someone ready to come back at him, no one else on that team really was able to step up and fill his shoes.
The level of competition wasn't a surprise, but it was still really fun to compete. You always want to compete against good players. I think one thing we sometimes fell victim to, not really my senior year, but years prior, we would kind of play to the level of our competition. And so when you play against a really good player, you tend to play better, and it's always fun to play against those guys.
I wasn't aware of the entire system, how it's structured, the conference, the sectionals, regionals, and all this. So one of the contributors to me being aware of what's happening and how far we are is, how to say, the number of people that started showing up to these games, the regionals and sectionals.
What was the crowd like?
Oh, it's phenomenal. I mean, the travel from the sectional all the way down to North Judson from the regional. When we went to the semi-state game down at Lafayette Jeff, I could barely hear my assistants, and they were right next to me. The crowd was so loud.
The energy that would be brought up even in the school, in the whole town. So I was slowly getting pumped up even more and more as the tournament was progressing. And then you see the teams that you play, they're much better, they're stronger, they're faster, they have bigger bench. It was getting tougher and tougher. So with each next round, all of us were okay. We got far, but we go one game at a time.
And then the state championship game, it stayed the same. Now, obviously the venue was a lot bigger, so there was maybe 12,000 people in there, but it holds, you know, 24,000. So it's a different venue. So it wasn't, you know, you couldn't necessarily hear it as much compared to at Lafayette Jeff. But yeah, the crowd was amazing. The whole run was, you know, people coming out of the woodwork from Wheeler, from, you know, you saw people from the 70s and stuff with Wheeler, old school Wheeler jackets. And literally it was amazing what it did for the community and for the school.
I had some superstition or some ritual that I would always be the last one running out of the locker room. And I remember as we started running onto the field, half of the arena, which there was a lot of people, I forget, it was, I don't know, 10,000 people or something. Like, there was a lot big crowd, and half of the Conseco field house was chanting USA, USA. And then when I, as the last guy on the team, came out on the court, the other half started cheering Serbia, Serbia. And this was like, okay, this is amazing feeling. I mean, I can't believe that this is happening.
What was your halftime speech like in the locker room?
Well, it depends. Every game was different. I mean, and again, you have to, as far as building relationships, like I talked about earlier, you got to know when to push the right buttons. If they expect you to come in yelling and screaming, that you might not have the same effect as if you come in and not yell and scream. So a perfect example of that was the sectional, the year we won the first sectional in 2007. The night before we had played Boone Grove, and I came in at halftime, and we were up by 10, and I went crazy on them. And they were kind of like, "Coach, we're up 10. You know, and my focus there was basically staying focused on what we did in the first half and not let up, kind of thing. Whereas then the following evening, we played Bishop Knoll for the championship, and we're down at halftime. And they're expecting me to come in yelling and screaming, and I come in more calm, talking about X's and O's and things we need to do differently to improve. So I think that's the biggest thing, is trying to understand, again, that goes back to being able to relate to your kids and building relationships to the point where you know what buttons you need to push to try to get them to play their best.
Did you come out of halftime like you wanted to?
The game was tight, low scoring. I think both teams were a little nervous. I think from the standpoint, you're playing in an NBA arena. I think our kids maybe struggled with the background. Now, we were able to go down there during the week and practice for an hour, but they give you an hour and only an hour.
Were there any specific moments that you remember from the game?
Yeah, at one point we were struggling to score in the third quarter, and we had an inbounds play underneath, and the clock was kind of running down, and Todorovic Batar hit a huge three that I think really changed the momentum for us, because we had at that point struggled in that game in particular from the three-point line, and I thought we were actually settling too much for threes instead of getting the ball inside to Kojcinovic and to Rudakas, and he hit a huge three that I thought kind of, you know, you kind of tense a little bit because of the game, state championship, and I thought that kind of loosened us up a little bit when he hit that three.
In the third quarter, Wheeler's lead started to slip. Describe Park Tudor's surge into the third.
Yeah, we had a senior-oriented team, like I said. We had guys, you know, Rudakas had played varsity since he was a freshman, and then Todorovic and Ketchum had played since they were sophomores. So we had an experienced group that, you know, I very rarely, you know, our guys knew what to do. Occasionally you'd have to call a timeout, come in and basically go over some things, maybe what they were trying to do to adjust to what we were doing. So X's and O's things. But our guys were really good. And that goes back to all the preparation we'd done over the years, which all started in practice and everything else that led up to those types of moments, to where it was more, we need to do a wrinkle here, or we need to do something a little bit different here. But our guys knew what those were, because it's all things that we'd covered in practice. So anytime there was any kind of run, if they went on like a 6-8-2 run and we'd have to use a timeout, you know, we just talk about things that we needed to get back to doing that made us successful to that point in the game.
You guys scored 0 field goals in the fourth quarter, but ended 20 for 28 on free throws. Do you think that was luck?
Well, it goes back to what I talked about earlier, about we started bringing the kids in December, shooting free throws in the morning twice a week for streaks, and the losers would run in the evenings, and we did that all the way up and through the playoffs, and our free throw percentage went up and up throughout the whole season. I mean, you could point to many games, like Rudakas in the semi-state, ends up going 8 for 8 down the stretch, scores 23 and 11. Huge at the foul line. Rudakas' free throw percentage went from like 65 to above 70 all the way through the playoff run. He had huge threes, and a lot of that had to do with us coming in for months in the morning prior to that, and it all paid off once we got into the tournament.
Big shot.
Clock in the lower right-hand corner.
Here's
to screen.
Your wing.
It's a second screen. Forces the issue. No. Rebound tipped. Kiker on the dribble. Farrell has to get it up. On the bounce. In time. No. And Wheeler, state champions for the first time in school history. Wheeler survived 3 late three-point attempts by Park Tudor's best player.
What were your emotions like once you realized you won the state title?
Well, I mean, I'm going to be honest. When we won the semi-state the week before, that brought me to tears from the standpoint of, I can't believe that we're going to state. Reporters came up to me right afterwards, and I kind of had to catch myself because the emotion of that situation, because of how close the Southwood game was, it kind of caught me and brought me to tears at the time, because I'm like, oh my, you know, we're going to the state finals, you know.
As this final call was being made, and you just realized that you won the state championship, we're all running into the field, you know, it's, you see the entire crowd being going crazy, and it was an amazing feeling. And then I remember, you know, for half an hour or an hour, you were really in a different state of mind. You were not aware of what happened, but you feel this amazing energy that I mean, I can't describe to this day. And
now we won the state championship. Obviously, I was extremely excited, but it was kind of like, you know, different. I kind of reflected more back on winning the state championship when I on the bus ride home, where I could sit back and say, kind of take a deep breath and say, oh, you know, I can't believe we did that kind of thing, and stuff that you think about down the road where you're like, I can't believe we actually did that. Whereas the emotion after the semi-state win was like, literally, reporters got in my face right away, and I was emotionally not quite ready for it at that time, because we were going to the state championship, and you know, oh my God, Wheeler's going to the state championship, you know, kind of thing.
Again, living three doors down, I mean, as a neighborhood even, we knew what was going on. And quite a few of us from the neighborhood went to watch the game, and we came back and we actually decorated the front of his house before he even got back. But it was, I mean, they had the fire trucks bringing them the bus back. I mean, for the small town, I mean, I remember being here at the school when they got back, and there were a ton of people here greeting the bus as it got back, and it was like they had just won the national championship. I mean, it was, for us, it was probably one of the most exciting things the school's ever had.
Did something that, you know, obviously had never been done in the history to this, even to this day, had never been done in the history of Porter County in boys or girls basketball.
Looking back, what are your thoughts on the team, and now how has the state run impacted your day-to-day life?
I think it brought us, it got us all together. We shared an experience that not a lot of people in our general area has experienced, and it was really cool. It was a really proud moment for a lot of people, and was happy to share that with them.
Were there any specific moments you remember from the final game?
Oh, it was a blast. I learned a lot from Coach Jones on things that you should do and how you should approach the game, especially from the coaching perspective. Before game day, on game day, you know, after, how you break things down. But if I have like a specific memory, you know, that was kind of fun for me anyway, sitting on the bench, is everybody's got like their mannerisms, right? And Coach Jones, he kind of had the jacket flip. So when things weren't necessarily going our way, or something in the game that had happened that we wanted, you know, it's easy to get frustrated. And so for him, the jacket, he flipped the jacket back and put his hands on his hips, and you knew right away something didn't go right.
There's one funny story that is really, really funny to a lot of us, and I think most kids would most of the team would agree to this, is there was a time where we were playing Morgan Township, and Jones was, we were killing him. Like, halftime, we were up probably like 30 points. He was not happy. Like, I don't know if he had some vendetta out for them or not, but he came in, he threw his clipboard down, and it bounced up and hit another coach, like in the leg area that might not be favorable. And he had to walk out because he started to laugh, but he didn't want us to see him laughing. Mm-hmm. And all the players, we didn't want to laugh in front of him, so we all hunch over and put our hands on our face, and the coach is like bent over because he just got hit with this clipboard, and he didn't mean to, obviously, but it was one of the memories of that senior year that stands out the most. It was just so funny the way it played out.
Did you have any offers to coach at a higher level?
I had a number of high school offers from pretty much every Doolin school in the area at some point. You know, that just comes with, one, my background as a player at Bobo High School and BU, and two, the success we had here.
What are your thoughts on Jones now?
I'm happy for him. I think he had a fantastic coaching career. It makes me kind of sad that he's not coaching. You know, that was something that I very much enjoyed and would have loved to have coached with him for a lot longer. That's not the way things worked out. I think it's great that he's stayed here at Wheeler, and that he's still building into young people's lives and the position that he has now in the high school. And, you know, it would have been easy for him, I think, to just leave and go do something else, because after you win state, I can guarantee offers and things are flooding in from all over the place, but to stay here and continue on, even though he's not coaching, I think is pretty special.
you know, so yeah, I had interviewed for a number of jobs over the years. I was just always happy here and turned down a number of those just because I, you know, people always said you came from Valpo and you're a Valpo guy, but I had been at Wheeler for so long, I told my players that I felt like I was more of a Wheeler guy than I ever was a Valpo guy just because I'd been at Wheeler teaching for longer than I'd ever been involved in Valpo, so.
Why did you stop coaching?
I stopped coaching in 2011 and had multiple chances again to get back into it. Most people thought I would get back into it because of the success I had when I was in it. But when I got out of it, I dealt with health issues at first, but then I ended up being able to coach my kids at the time who were young, and I was able to coach them in AAU, which I would not have been able to do if I was still head coaching as much. And I wanted to be able to be a part of that more because I was kind of missing some of my oldest, Curtis's, when we were making that run. I was missing some of the stuff that he was doing.
How important is family to you?
Well, it's everything. I mean, like I said, my wife is Susan, has sacrificed everything to allow me to do it. And if you want to do it right, coaching is a all year round job. So I had to put a lot of time into it that, you know, caused me maybe at that point not to be around as much as I would have liked with the kids, especially when they were that little. So she was having to take a lot of that responsibility. But again, she was willing to help me chase that dream, so to speak, that I had.
What did you see in the future of the program after winning state?
Well, I mean, for me, the biggest thing I took pride in was the standpoint where we're going to take the program to, we're going to walk no matter where we go, you're going to have to respect Wheeler High School when they come. And that was the biggest thing for me, was having our kids never back down no matter what the other uniform said. And I think that's the biggest thing I took pride in, is that we carried ourselves like a champion when we walked around, whether you beat us or not, which, you know, we lost just as much as we won at times. But our guys carried ourselves like winners, and that was the biggest thing I was trying to have our program be about.
State your name.
I'm Jalen Lewis, and I'm a senior at Wheeler High School.
What were your first impressions of Mr. Jones?
Well, before I had him as a teacher, you know, I've really only heard good things about him. Of course, students always ask, how are certain teachers, how is so-and-so's class? And you hear a lot of, you'll either like this person or you won't like that person, but everyone who's ever had him really only says good things about him.
After you got done coaching, why did you choose to keep teaching at Wheeler?
I've always loved it here. I felt like, I felt like Wheeler gave me the opportunity when I got out of college, when I didn't really have there's really no openings teaching-wise anywhere, you know, and I'd looked into some other things and I'd interviewed for some other things, but nothing really quite worked out. And I felt like Wheeler was really the only one that kind of reached out to me from the standpoint of, okay, you don't have a teaching opening, so to speak, but we still have some opportunities for you to come in here and coach. And they had promised me that if I came in and coached and something would come open from a teaching perspective, that they'd be willing to help me out, you know, and that's all I was really asking for.
What impact do you think Jones has on Wheeler and the students in Wheeler?
Mike is a calming effect, and he can talk to the kids like he's their friend. And I think that's the big difference. You know, he can be goofy, he can be funny, but he also cares. And he knows what's going on in their daily lives. And you know, I think that's important to the kids. They see that he cares, and he's been here forever, and he's got kind of a legacy here. So that kind of means a lot, I think, to the kids, knowing, for those that know, kind of what he's done and what he's meant to the school in the past.
Did you enjoy his class?
100% I enjoyed his class. The atmosphere of his class is just so inviting, one, and it's just so fun. When you have friends in there that you're really good friends with, and on top of Jones just being a very social guy that anyone can get along with, you know, so his class was really enjoyable.
Do you enjoy being around students all day?
Yeah, I mean, again, like I said, it keeps me young. Just watching you guys try to strive for things, whether it be in a classroom setting, weight room setting, playing games, talking about things in life, whatever it might be, it just keeps me young knowing that, you know, you're trying to have an impact. You know, I think everybody that I associate with, I think, feels like they can come and talk to me about things. They got something going on in their life, especially the guys that I coached. I really spent time building relationships with guys that I coached over the years that still reach out to me to this day. and say things to me that, you know, make you feel good as a coach that you never really thought maybe they understood what you were saying. But then they come back and communicate with you and makes you feel good about it. And that can be in a classroom too, because I've had it happen both ways.
What was he like in class?
He was a very just like calm, cool, collected type of dude, but when he needed to bring that energy, he brought it 100%. From yelling across the field house for guys to finish their last lap for the mile, or just bringing that energy for dodgeball every Thursday, he brought it.
Do you have any memorable moments being a gym or health teacher?
Well, I have memorable moments back when I used to coach with, back at the time Ryan Turley was coaching. One, I remember the running, the mile runs. We used to always run for times every Tuesday, and using the Ultrac 330 water resistant watch with a brand new battery and all that, and the excitement for that, and kids coming in there and actually trying to push kids to achieve things that aren't necessarily athletes, but running times that maybe they've never accomplished before. I've always enjoyed doing that, trying to get them to achieve something that maybe they didn't think they could achieve.
What was running the mile like in freshman year?
No, it was fun, you know, watching bodies drop because people were tired and Jones just blasting music in the background. I mean, it was a good time.
I feel like things like that help you learn something about yourself. You know, kids that maybe quit on that compared to kids that fight through that stuff. That stuff I've always enjoyed, trying to have seeing a student think they can't do something and then pushing them to a point where they accomplish that. That's always something that always makes me feel good about coming in, you know, every day.
Has Jones been an inspiration in any way to you?
100%. Jones, even though it's just a gym class, Jones pushes everyone to do their best, and I've kind of taken that and applied it to the rest of the areas of my life, whether it be in basketball or my art or just school and life in general. It's kind of good. He's a great motivator.
What do you want other people to see your legacy as?
I would say just something that, you know, I was fair. I tried to build relationships with everyone I came across, whether it be the best athlete or the, you know, person that's in a choir or whatever it may be. I've always tried to build boy, girl, whoever it is, whoever I have in class or run across in the hallway. That's why I try to greet everybody in the hallways every day, just because I want to make sure that, you know, I try to reach out to people. As far as building relationship wise. And it may just be somebody I never have in class. I may just see him pass in the hallway. Maybe they're not having a very good day. If I can say something to brighten up their day, that maybe they can, in the future, they can come back and maybe say something to me that maybe I didn't even know I had an impact on. Those are the kind of things I'm just trying to do. Because, you know, we all don't always have good days. And sometimes just saying some encouraging comment to somebody can help. That's all I try to do.
How do you think more teachers or coaches can be like Coach Jones?
I think one of the best things about Jones as a teacher is that, like I said earlier, even though it's just a gym class, he really pushes people to do their best, you know? And he really wants the best for people and will push them to the extreme. And that's a really great quality as a coach and a teacher.
Final question. What is the edge in the chase?
The edge is when you start out to try to accomplish something, and then in between you have the edge, which is one thing, and then you have an orange, so to speak, and you have the green, which is the chase, which is down the edge in the chase or in between, and you're trying to get through all the obstacles that come in play in between, and a lot of those obstacles are things that are trying to stop you from achieving that goal. And that's basically what I'm trying to do, because you're going to have things that get in the way of you trying to achieve whatever goal you want to accomplish. And all I'm trying to get people to do, whether it be run the mile, you know, we do things in short-term goals because we talk about short-term goals equals long-term success.
Everyone needs to have the same goal in mind, and everyone needs to want it. We wanted it really bad, and we worked really hard. We understood the assignment, and that's what we did. We put the time in.
But no one is someone until I tell them who. This is the way that it is.
And Wheeler, state champions for the first
Rudakas head coach and Mike Jones.
Try to follow your dream, whatever that would be. I mean, obviously, I have a lot of catchphrases I use all the time. But as far as trying to just be who you are, whatever that may be, if you have a dream to do something, don't back down. Try to go for that dream. You know, like my phrases, like follow your heart, be the change, all that. Shock the world before the world shocks you.
They're gonna execute the mother to elevate the man. Eliminate the youth. They're gonna blind date everyone until you love them.